Now, our first point today, and you can see the, I hope you can see the whiteboard behind me. We're going to look about four different things, and we got several kings or rulers or generals that we're going to talk about. The first one is probably the most important to get the whole setting. His name is Alexander the Great. Now, if you've had history in high school or in college, you know about Alexander the Great. He took over the kingdom of Macedonia when he was 22 years old. His father died. He took it over, had to kill a few people, as kings always did, to get the reins of authority. And then he started the conquest. He started the conquest all over the world until at the age of 33 years old, he died of a mysterious disease. But he had conquered the then known world, and historians and some, some of this is just a legend, says that he conquered all the then known world, and then at his young age, he wept because there were no more countries to conquer. Now that's the secular history. I want to give you the biblical history of that. And not that it's written in scripture, although Daniel talks about the coming of the king that will defeat the Persians, and that's Alexander the Great. And I'll tell you about that in just a moment. But Alexander the Great was great in another way, is that he had an encounter with God. And as we taught before on all of these kings, you got Cyrus, you got Nebuchadnezzar, you've got Darius, and you've got Xerxes and Artaxerxes, and you've got all of these kings during the intertestamental period and leading up to it that God encountered them in some significant way. Now, we're not saying all these guys were saved because they encountered God. They encountered God, and like Nebuchadnezzar posted a command to all of his peoples and all of his kingdoms that they should worship the God of the Jews because he is the God, creator of the universe, and they recognized who God was. But as Romans chapter 1 says, they recognized him as God, but they didn't give thanks. They didn't worship him. And they developed other gods and other theories, and they gave themselves over to idolatry and then to adultery. So we have all these contexts. But leading up to Alexander the Great had all of these men that had encounters with God. Alexander the Great had an encounter with God that was very powerful. It's not written about in your history books, but Josephus, who is a Jewish historian, the most prominent Jewish historian, he lived from 37 AD to 100 AD. He was a Jew living in Rome, very eloquent, very educated, and he was the historian for the Roman Empire. He was writing the history of the Jews. It's called The Antiquity of the Jews. You can look it up online. I will put a link to that on my website so you can read these documents for yourself. I think that's very important that you read these things. Now, Josephus writes concerning Alexander the Great and his conquest and his coming to Jerusalem. That's what's significant. Let me give you the context of that. Alexander the Great had been conquering the world. He had just finished off Egypt, and now he was coming into Syria and then into Israel. As he comes down and he begins to occupy all the cities along the coastline, he comes to the city of Gaza. And there he sends a message to Jerusalem and to the priests there and to the rulers and saying, I'm coming to Jerusalem and I expect you to provide me with armies and with funds for my warfare. And the high priest, who was in charge of everything, sent the memo back to him and said, sir, we can't do that because we've made our commitments to Darius, to King Darius, and our allegiance is to him. Well, that incensed Alexander the Great, and he said, well, as soon as I'm finished here in Gaza, I'm coming after you guys, and I'm going to show you how to show proper respect. So Alexander the Great was angry at Jerusalem and angry at the people of Israel, and he was coming in to attack and to conquer. Well, that was a concern to the people of Israel. Now, a backstory to this is that there was another character living in Samaria who, if you remember, the Samaritans and the Jews didn't get along. Well, Sanballat, who opposed the Jews in the construction of the temple, heard about Alexander the Great and his conquest in coming through. And so he said, let's send him 7,000 soldiers. So he goes out to meet Alexander the Great at Gaza and then presents 7,000 soldiers and says, we will fund you. We will be with you. We will fight for you. We'll do everything with you. Now, if we do that, what are you going to give us in return? And Alexander said, what do you want me to do? And he said, well, I'd like you to build us a temple. There's a temple in Jerusalem, but we don't believe that one. We want our own temple on Mount Gerizim. And so Alexander the Great said, I will fund you the building of your temple if you'll follow me. And so Sanballat and his crew followed him, and they were able to build the temple on Mount Gerizim in just 7 months, which is quite amazing. It took 40 years to build Herod's temple or rebuild the temple. Now, with that in mind, you remember John chapter 4, where Jesus encountered the woman at the well. And the woman at the well wanted to argue theology with him. And so as Jesus started to tell the truth of the word of God and that she could drink from the well, she'd never have thirst again, she said, oh, you're a theologian. The Jews say that you ought to worship in Jerusalem. We say we ought to worship on Mount Gerizim. Where do you think we ought to worship? And Jesus gave that wonderful statement that though they that worship God should worship God in spirit and in truth, not on this mountain or that mountain, but in their hearts worship the Lord. And that's the Mount Gerizim where they built the temple. All right, now they built the temple. Alexander the Great finishes up everything in Gaza and says, I'm coming after Jerusalem. So he takes his whole army and he marches across the country toward Jerusalem. In the meantime, the high priest is in Jerusalem and he has a dream. And God comes to him and says, you are not going to have to fight Alexander the Great. He is not going to conquer this country. I am going to intervene and you're going to be rescued. But here's what I want you to do. I want you and all of your priests to dress in your fineries, which was all of their garments, along with the high priest having his big shield in the front, which had all kinds of jewels in it. And he said, I want you to dress up in all your finery, and I want all the people to dress up in white, and I want you to march out to meet Alexander the Great. And so they had a 7-day fast, and they prepared themselves, and they got torches, and they marched all night to go out to meet Alexander the Great. And when Alexander the Great and his army come over the hill toward Jerusalem, they're this massive parade of people coming at them. The priest in the front of the line with their torches, and Alexander the Great looks and he's astounded and he falls on his knees, actually runs up to the high priest, falls on his knees before the high priest and does obeisance. That is, he worships or gives respect to the high priest. His right-hand man says, sir, sir, you don't want to do that to a high priest of Jerusalem. You are the king of kings. You are the ruler of the whole earth. Why would you give this kind of obeisance to the high priest? And what's significant is Alexander the Great tells the story. He said, before I began my conquest, I had a dream. And in that dream, I saw this very picture of this priest and all of these people in their white and all of these garments that are before me. And in that dream, the God of these people said, I am going to give you the nations. I am going to give you the power to conquer all of these nations, for I am with you. And he identified it that these people were his people. And so Alexander the Great said, I am not bowing before this man. I'm bowing before the God of this man, the God of this high priest, because he visited me and he gives me power to conquer. And let me read to you what he actually says. This is from Josephus. That's why it's important to read Josephus and all of the history of the Jews. It really is intriguing. And here's what Alexander the Great said, according to Josephus. I did not adore him, but that God who has honored him with his high priesthood, for I saw this very person in a dream, in this very habit, in other words, in the same clothing, when I was in Dios of Macedonia, who, when I was considering with myself how I might obtain dominion of Asia, he exhorted me to make no delay, but boldly pass over the sea thither, and that he would conduct my army and give me the dominion over the Persians, which it is that having seen no other habit, no other clothing like this, no other people that stood before me matched this dream, and now seeing this person in it and remembering that vision and the exhortation which I had in my dream, I believe that I bring this army under divine conduct and shall therewith conquer Darius and destroy the powers of the Persians, and that all things will succeed according to my own plan. And that is amazing. And the rest of the story is that the high priest took Alexander the Great to Jerusalem, brought him into the temple, and showed him the wonders of the temple. And then he gave him the scrolls of the book of Daniel and said, I want you to see that God, Yahweh, has already predicted that you were going to come and you were going to conquer the world. And so they opened Daniel and they read to him. And in our notes, they give you the exact passages that he read. And he read them, these passages, and Alexander the Great said, this is awesome. This is the God. This is the true God. And he worshiped the Lord. The high priest took him into the temple, cleansed him, did the bathing and everything else, and got him prepared to worship. And Alexander the Great came in and offered sacrifices to the Lord God of Israel. That is an amazing story. That is absolutely amazing and astounding. Now, secular historians will debunk it and say, well, Josephus didn't know what he's talking about. That's just a made-up legend of the Jews. And it's not. They said the same thing about David. They said the same thing about Esther. These liberal theologians don't want to believe anything in the Bible that has to do with miracles or prophecy. They say it's not possible to predict the future. And so when Isaiah predicted Cyrus, they said, well, that was written years later after the fact because nobody can predict the future. And so it is. Be careful when you read history in the secular realm because they are influenced by their own philosophies and their own ideas. We look to the Word of God and we look to men like Josephus. He wasn't a godly man. He was considered a traitor by the Jews because he lived among the Romans and actually lived in the Palatine, the great like Hollywood circle, and was very close to the emperor himself. And Josephus writes these things and much more. When we get into the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD, Josephus writes concerning that destruction of Jerusalem and what went on. He actually said, I have eyewitness accounts of people that talk about the Shekinah glory being lifted up from the temple before it's destroyed and brought to the Mount of Olives. And there it was for many years. And the people of God worshiped there on the Mount of Olives. These are wonderful stories, and you only get them by reading history. So I want to encourage you to get the Antiquities of the Jews by Josephus. You can find it online, or you don't have to pay for it at all. I actually have my own library, and it's available online, that has all of these books, Josephus and Alfred Edersheim and Herodotus and a bunch of others that have authored many wonderful books about history, including the apocryphal books and the pseudepigrapha. We'll talk about that in another lesson. All of those are online for you to access and read for yourself. I think it's a wonderful story and really sets up the whole context of what happened at Hanukkah.